Hi, I'm James Schillinglaw, and I'm here with a familiar face, Lisa Lutoff-Perlo, who is the president and CEO of Celebrity Cruises. And we wanted to talk to Lisa about a recent announcement that Celebrity made about a new program called Always Included. And we also obviously want to talk about some of the questions du jour about the CDC and restarting cruising. And there is a lot to talk about with Celebrity. And you're going to find out about all that and more on Insider Travel Report. Now, Lisa, first of all, I always ask these days, first of all, how are you and where are you?
Well, thank you for asking, James. I'm well, thank you. I'm hanging in there, doing well. Thank goodness that our immediate family has been spared any impact from this terrible pandemic.
You have a son in travel too, so you know.
I have a son in travel. Yeah, he's up in Massachusetts. They fared better than Florida. Yeah. So I do have a son in travel, and but I'm in Florida, in Plantation, Florida, in my home, in my office, where I have been since the middle of March, like most of us.
No, and I'm sure we've always started when I've gotten out and travel. I've done a little bit more traveling than you have, but we want to get on a cruise, that's for sure.
Yeah, we sure do.
And when we get on the cruise, and that's sort of the headliner of this interview, is Celebrity just unveiled what you were calling Always Included. And this is a new program that really aims to simplify what is included in the cruise fare. Talk a little bit about, if you could, this program and what it offers.
Well, you know, one of the things that's been really interesting for us and nice for us, you know, every day I wake up, I say I'm going to look for a silver lining in the COVID-19 cloud. And one of the things that we wanted to do here at Celebrity was to think about how we would reemerge from this pandemic and when we came back into service, and how our brand might look a little different than before, you know, we shut down back in March. And there were a few things that were important to us, but it also helped us to focus on our brand in a really positive way. And it helped us focus on the future. And we've always been, not always, but I would say for the last 7 years or so, we have been a brand that has included things in the price of our cruise, right?
Right.
We've usually left it up to the consumer. We usually let them pick one, two, or three things. And we decided that when we reemerged, we really wanted to be a brand that was more inclusive, since we were going in that direction anyway. We also took a look at the segment of the market that we're very interested in attracting now that we've come out of this pandemic, or we're coming out on the other side of it. And one of the things that's very much a trend now in luxury, or new luxury, as we like to describe it ourselves, is simplicity. Mm-hmm. And when we were doing all of our market research, we heard loud and clear 3 out of 4 people want everything included in the cruise fare. They don't want to pay the cruise fare and then have to add other things. It's number one, more complicated. And number two, they would just like to know the price up front and that they're going to get these things. And the three things they said they wanted were gratuities, Wi-Fi, and beverage packages.
Well, I know, being a journalist, I always want Wi-Fi. So
there you go. Right. Yeah. So anyway, that was sort of what made us go in this direction now. And so we a week ago today, we launched Always Included. And today we've just opened up where we have a big announcement today, actually, where we are announcing our itineraries for late 21 and into the winter of 22.
Okay, we'll be looking for that one, because I want to get that story out for you. Now, one of the questions I was going to ask is, you know, why are you launching this during a pandemic? Would you have launched it? You think you would have launched it anyway if this crisis hadn't occurred, or maybe, you know, or was this just something that you're trying to get people started and really thinking about Celebrity and what it offers?
I don't know if we would have launched it anyway. We might have. You know, we were starting doing to do some strategic work for our brand moving forward. As our Edge series comes in, we were thinking about our longer term strategy. I think that one of the things that this pause in our business gave us the opportunity to do was pivot and think about our future and our longer term strategy earlier than we were thinking about. So I do believe that this was a direction that we took. We partnered with a great company that focuses on luxury brands and luxury branding. And, you know, we came to the conclusion that being more inclusive as a brand was very much in line with who Celebrity is and also what our customers want. So I don't know if I know the answer to your question, but I do know that I think what we ended up doing is going to be a meaningful change for our brand and also our ability to attract the guests that we're most interested in bringing with us on Celebrity.
Well, I also wondered whether this also is a part of a trend in general in cruising, especially in premium cruising, where increasingly they are, you know, lines are becoming more inclusive.
So I think, I'm not sure about the premium space. I think when the brands in the premium space become more inclusive, it's tied to a promotion. Okay. And one thing we don't want to, you know, we're really trying to get off that hamster wheel of these never-ending promotions and which ship does it apply to and for what period of time and what staterooms, et cetera, et cetera. We really wanted to go out there and say, listen, no matter what ship you're on or what you're booking for Celebrity, these things are always included in the fare that you pay.
Well, and that goes to another thing. I mean, is this program going to affect your pricing overall since you will have more included? Will prices go up? Or is this just a way to attract more cruisers with better value as we emerge from the crisis?
It's both. You know, my job is to make sure that cruises, the price of cruises goes up, right, James? That's what I was hired to do.
Well, so. And actually for travel advisors, that's important too, because as the price goes up, their commissions go up.
That's right. Absolutely. And that's another really important distinction of this program is that, you know, whatever the price of these cruises are, with all of these things included, our travel advisors earn commission on the entire fare. And for all of us coming out of this, that's a really good thing. And I think consumers are looking for value. They're not necessarily looking for the lowest price. And these things that we have included now in our cruise have a tremendous amount of value. Mm-hmm. And the value that you get by paying for them before you go on the cruise is better than what you would pay if you just paid the cruise fare and bought them separately. So while the prices are not going to necessarily stay the same and they're certainly not going to go down, the value is still better by booking an always included vacation with Celebrity.
No, and I've long maintained the more you can include in the price initially, the better. You know, and again, I don't know if this is going to reach down to sort of the contemporary level of cruising, but I thought for luxury and for premium that this was going to increasingly be the trend where people want to pay one price and get kind of everything they want. And so you've certainly done that. And so since I've always thought Celebrity is being at the top of the premium category, you know, some people ask me, is this a move that Celebrity is going to do be luxury now? And I don't know if that's how you view it or not. I mean, I always thought there are definitely a lot of elements of luxury cruising in a Celebrity experience.
So I completely agree with you. And, you know, just to point out a couple of them, number one, the retreat, our retreat experience, right, with suite accommodations, that is a very luxurious experience. And everything is already included with that experience. Celebrity Flora down in the Galapagos, a very luxurious experience. And there are a lot of elements within the regular Celebrity cruise that are very luxurious. And I think you know, James, that quite a few years ago, we've categorized ourselves as modern luxury. We've nuanced that a little bit now and call ourselves more new luxury, but it really is a space in all of this categorization of cruising that the consumer really doesn't understand.
Right.
But we've put ourselves squarely in the middle of premium and luxury because that's where we believe we belong.
Okay.
But even within our even within our new luxury experience, to your point, there are very luxurious elements of the Celebrity cruise that clearly help us compete very strongly in the luxury space.
No, and absolutely. And I think you're there. And we're all kind of siloed into these luxury premium, small ship premium, big ship premium, and then contemporary, and the spaces, the lines between all these different categories are kind of are getting increasingly hard to define. So as I tell people, you can have a luxury experience on a contemporary ship with a lot of sweet products. You can definitely have it on a premium ship. So it's simplified for us journalists and travel advisors, I think, at the end.
Yeah.
And maybe consumers for some, you know, but it is different products for different folks. So I think what you're doing is great, and I'm looking forward to it. Let's shift gears a little bit here. We had this something called the CDC Framework for Resumption of Sailing that came out of when we've all had to read 40 pages of that, which is interesting, as well as the recommendations from the Healthy Sail Panel, which you're a part of, as part of Royal Caribbean Group. What's your best guess as to when you at Celebrity Cruises will be back in the water next year?
I don't think we know 100%. You know, I wish I had a crystal ball. That is probably the question that
I was looking for the definitive date, and I was going to hold you to it. So
it is the number one question on everybody's mind, including ours, I might add. So listen, I ask the same question every day. When do you think we're going to be able to cruise again? And so here's what I'll say about that. While I don't know the answer 100%, I do know we'll be cruising in 2021, so that's a good thing. Okay. We're all doing our best to get back as soon as possible, but I think what we've always said, at least here in our company, is we're much more focused on doing it right than just coming back into service. You know, the lifting of the no sail order and replacing that with the conditional sail order.
Right.
To your point, it's 40 pages, and there were not a lot of the technical specifications of the things that we had to do in that original 40-page report. And so we're working through that with the CDC now. There are a lot of things that we have to do sequentially through our entire fleet. If you're going to have a ship start up out of a U.S. port, that we're still working through the timing of that and trying to figure out when we think we might be able to get back into service. And so the encouraging thing, the silver lining, again, I'll go back to my silver linings. The silver lining is we see a pathway forward. And it's okay. It was a long 7 months with no pathway forward. We have a very close collaboration, very open dialogue with the CDC. Our teams are working around the clock, figuring out the protocols and what we need to do and when we need to do it, so that we can eventually resume cruising, because we know that there's a lot of pent-up demand for people to take their vacations. And, you know, we're seeing a lot of good forward-looking business. And so we know that people do want to cruise, but we want to make sure that we do it and keep our guests and crew very healthy.
Well, I saw all the different phases of the CDC, and everybody has to go through that, and they have to agree to it, and the CDC has to oversight it. I mean, you know, it's going to take a while. I mean, we hope sooner rather than later. And by the way, since everybody's volunteering to be test candidates, I'll raise my hand if you're going to accept any test candidates for a Celebrity. All right, you and I can go and be the guinea pigs if you want. There's nothing worse than being on an always included luxury experience on Celebrity while you're trying to test this, right?
I'll be on all of them. So if you want to. I'm going to let our team know that you need to be on the invitation. You're on the volunteer list.
I'm on the volunteer. It's a hard job, but somebody's got to do it, as they say. Now let's talk a little bit about what the pandemic has done to your fleet, because I'll have to admit to you that when this all started, I was actually heading over to Europe almost to get on your Celebrity Apex.
Right.
The event in Southampton.
Yes.
I that was going to be an amazing time, and it was going to be, I was really looking forward to it. But what's happened to the fleet during this period, and specifically, you know, new ships like the Apex, and I think, where have they been staying at this point, and how are they being positioned as we resume?
Well, they're in a few different places. The majority of our fleet right now is sitting off the coast of the Bahamas.
Okay.
Celebrity joined her sister ships, her sister ship, Celebrity Edge, and her other sisters in the Celebrity fleet on October 13th. She finally made her way over from Europe, where she has been since we took delivery of her in March. And yes, we had to cancel all of her wonderful inaugural festivities, but we're looking forward to rescheduling those in the not too distant future.
Okay.
So that's where most of them are. We have a couple off the West Coast, the Millennium and Eclipse, because they were over on the West Coast, coming back from different locations and actually getting ready to go up to do their Alaska season, which didn't end up happening. And then Solstice is still over. When we stopped service, Solstice was over in Australia, Southeast Asia, and she's been over there. So most of the ships are here local to South Florida, but a few others are spread out. And then, of course, we have our three Galapagos ships down off the coast of the Galapagos as well. We've got minimal manning is what we call it. So there are, I'd say, about 80 to 90 crew on each ship.
Right.
And they are keeping all systems running. They're keeping the ships in really good shape so that when we're finally ready to come back into service, the ships will be prepared to come back into service. And then as we phase the ships back into service, of course, we'll call back the crew in chunks and get them all trained on all of the new protocols and start up the ships one by one.
Well, it sounds like they're well positioned. And that sort of goes to my next question, which obviously, your itineraries for 2021 have really been affected now. We all thought we'd be back by now, but have you had to change your itineraries for 2021? Are you going to have more cruises closer to home, such as in the Caribbean, Alaska, Canada, Bermuda? Are you going to run anything in Europe or Asia at this point, at least what you're planning is? You mentioned we're looking forward to the itineraries you're going to put out today for, I guess, 22 and beyond. But what's going to happen for next year?
So the itineraries that we put out today are, are from November 1st of 2021 through the winter of 2022. And none of those itineraries have changed, right? Because that's technically when the no-sail order is going to be lifted and there's no restriction on the length of cruise out of a U.S. port.
Right
now, we are still planning our European season. And those ships can operate on their original itineraries. Now, when they operate, we're still waiting to see, but in Europe, they can operate on their normal itineraries because they are not sailing out of a U.S. port, unless, of course, the governments in Europe have different requirements. And that's very possible as well. We talk a lot about the CDC and the requirements, but we also have governments all over the world and all over Europe that also have their own protocols. And so we're watching closely and waiting for them to let us know, what their requirements are going to be. The cruises that would normally operate in Alaska will operate in Alaska. We still will have Bermuda cruises as we normally do. We'll still have Caribbean cruises as we normally do, but we may have to alter some of the itineraries, which we haven't done yet or announced yet, depending on how long the CDC keeps the no longer than 7-night rule in place.
Right. Yeah, that's right. There is that element with the 7 days. Right. 14 days is really, you can't do at this point.
Right.
Yeah, but it sounds like you have enough of your fleet is positioned well in the Caribbean to offer, at least when you restart, some Caribbean cruises. So,
yes.
And then, of course, everybody loves Alaska, and when that season begins later, towards the end of the spring, it sounds like you're positioned for that as well. So, but I assume you don't think you're going to be doing a full slate of cruises right away, at least until until November when you are publishing these itineraries.
Depending on when we start, we'll phase in over time. So one depends on the other, right? When all the ships will be back into service. But clearly it's going to take, it takes a lot to start up a ship again. And so as you can imagine, it's going to have to be phased in approach. And it will take a little bit of time to get all these ships back up and back into service. There's a lot of moving parts.
Yeah, and you mentioned Europe, and I know there are at least three large ships operating there, but they've had some challenges, and not just because of government regulation, but because some of the markets that they serve have seen surges in pandemic, and some shut down, not because the government told them to shut down, but because they didn't have any guests coming aboard, or they got their guests canceling. So it's going to be interesting to see how that season emerges. And you're right that you're not, the CDC isn't governing over there, but you've got a whole lot of other people doing that.
Yeah, we do.
Now let's talk a little bit about, you mentioned Galapagos. Do you expect to see some cruises there in 2021?
Absolutely. We do. Flora will be the first ship that we start up. Again, I can't tell you when. We have different scenarios based on different times. But yes, the Galapagos will start up again. And believe it or not, we have a lot of demand for the Galapagos. People really want to go see that beautiful part of the world.
No, that it's really one of those cruises that's kind of a bucket list, and I know it's on my bucket list, and I will get there at some point. We'll see what happens, but it's just one of these things that. But you have to, you know, obviously have to get out of Ecuador and go down there and see what their regulations are going to be. Yeah. Well, we talked a lot about silver linings, and that was one of my last questions, and you've already talked a lot about that. But can you talk a little bit about how Celebrity has evolved as a company during the pandemic, if you could, in general terms, about there have been silver linings, as much as having no cruises is not a silver lining at all.
You know, it's interesting whenever, I never judge how things are going in good times. And because it's easy for things to go well in good times. And I remember when we started 2020, it was, we were on pace to have another historic year. We've been having, the team has done such an amazing job here at Celebrity for so many years, and our performance just gets better and better and stronger and stronger. Our fleet gets stronger. We win more awards. Our guests love our experience. Financial performance, everything. And then all of a sudden, everything just came to an end in March. And I think how we've all changed in our company, and especially on our brand, is that, this really tough time has shown me personally what we're made of here. We are, no one gives up on any given day. Everybody still has the same amount of passion, enthusiasm, commitment to get this brand back, and that's another reason why our strategic thinking was something that was so important, because we don't want to just come back. We want to come back better than when we left. And that's so much of what the team has been focused on. And so I think what I've learned during this pandemic is that, when you work with an extraordinarily committed group of people who are smart, and you have a brand as strong and wonderful as ours, you see that within all of this terrible thing that we've had to manage through, live through, and deal with, all of us, there's no one ever gives up, and everybody stays strong, and the team's gotten stronger. I'm on Zoom with my team all the time, and they tell me all the time, this has made us a really, really stronger as a brand and as a team. And I think those are the silver linings that that we continue to focus on as we try to find our way out of this mess that we're still in.
Well, it does seem so long ago that you and I were on a panel at the New York Times Travel Show in this past January, and little did we know what was going to happen. I mean, there were some inklings about this, but nowhere near what happened in the end. But I'm even trying to remember what we talked about back then, but because the world changed as we knew it after that. So it's been
sustainable tourism. It was a big topic of that panel.
That's right. It was. You're right. That was it. Well, we had a lot of sustainable travel people. That was interesting. Right. That was it. Is there anything else you want to tell our travel advisors out there about either the new program, Always Included, or anything else about Celebrity?
Well, listen, all I want to say to the travel advisors out there is, number one, I want to say thank you, because even through all of this, they have been so wonderful. They've been greatly, greatly impacted by this, by what this pandemic has done to our industry. Tourism industry in general, right, has been the hardest hit by this pandemic. Certainly cruise took that to a whole different level, but I know our travel advisors have been hit really hard by this pandemic. And the only thing I would like to say is that we're here with them every step of the way. They have all of our good wishes and our gratitude for, what they've all done as we continue through this journey. I would say that there's hope. We've had two great vaccine announcements within the 2-week period of time that we didn't talk about, James, but between Pfizer and Moderna, this is really, really good news for our industry. And so there's light at the end of the tunnel. And I hope as we all come out of this that they all fare well and are able to hang in there, because I know that it has been really, really hard for all of them. So you have all of my good wishes and all of my gratitude.
No, that's wonderful. And I know many of the travel advisors I speak with saying that bookings for 21 are really looking good, you know, and beyond even now. We now have itineraries well into 23 for some lines. It's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
But so they're looking ahead as long as they can get through this period. But it's really been, and I always tell the cruise lines, maybe always included should include a vaccine too, whatever you like. I mean, because right now, you know, well, step aboard, you get a vaccine, you got your choice of Moderna or Pfizer, whichever one you want, the 90% and the 94% effective, you know, I mean.
That
for a while I said it should be COVID test, but I think I've moved to which actually is one of the protocols that all the cruise industry has agreed to, which is
multiple COVID tests.
Multiple COVID tests on board, but now maybe we got to move to the vaccine. We'll see what happens.
There you go. As long as there's like such great progress being made, the vaccine is certainly a game changer for all of us. You know, because number one, it will prevent us from getting this horrible, horrible virus. And that, you know, first and foremost is what we really have to pray for, because too many people have been impacted by this and too many lives have been lost and too many families have suffered. And so the vaccine is just really welcome news.
Absolutely. Well, Lisa, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with us again. It's been wonderful to see you. And I think I'm seeing you in a little bit anyway after this. So we're living on Zoom, but hopefully we'll see each other live soon. Thank you again for talking with us about Always Included and everything else that's going on with Celebrity.
My pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity, James. And we'll give you a call when we're ready to take volunteers for Apex.
There you go. As long as you're on it, we'll go and have a socially distant drink together somewhere on one of your ships.
Deal. Talk to you later. Thanks so much.
I'm James Schillinglaw, and this is Insider Travel Report.